Okay, hello, my name is Adam Warski. Thanks a lot for coming and thanks a lot for having me. So I'm going to talk about Akka HTTP and Akka HTTP session, which is an extension that I wrote. If you have any questions, just let me know right away. Okay, so what's the rough plan for the next 30-40 minutes? Is it big enough? That's the first question from me. Yeah? Okay, thanks. So first we will look at Akka HTTP directives and routes. So maybe some of you are familiar, we will, maybe not, we will take a kind of a shallow dive to see how these things work. This will be a coding part, then there will be a couple of slides to refresh some session concepts. Session in the sense of web sessions, as you probably know them. And finally we will try to use Akka HTTP session to implement sessions using Akka HTTP. Okay, so just so that you know who's talking to you, I'm a software engineer. I'm doing mainly Scala, that's why I'm here. I'm the co-founder of SoftwareMill, which is a software service company from Poland. We do a lot of software in Scala, but also Java and JavaScript, because everybody's doing JavaScript, I guess. We work for clients all around the world. I'm also doing some open source software like QuickLens, Macquarie, and others. I have a blog and Twitter account, which you're invited to visit. And yeah, I guess that's it for the introduction part. So now let's jump to Akka HTTP. So we will start with a short demo of a very simple application written using Akka HTTP. So Akka HTTP is based on Akka, so we will need, as an entry point, we will need an actor system, which will be implicit. So that's the first thing that we need. The second thing that we need, Akka HTTP is based on Akka streams, which is the reactive streams implementation. You don't really see it when you use Akka HTTP, but it's there, and you need an actor stream materializer. So that's an object which knows how to turn a stream description into something that you can actually run. So we will use the actor materializer and we will import system.dispatcher. Okay, so that's a set of implicits that you just need to have in scope to run an Akka HTTP application. You can consider it boilerplate if you'd like. Okay, so now for a very simple app, we will write a server which will respond to under demo one, it will return hello world. So quite simple. So we'll create a description of how our server should behave. So we will say, so what we need first to do is we need to have an import of the directives. I will explain what a directive is in a second. Akka HTTP Scala DSL server directives. Okay, so this gives us a nice DSL for building up our HTTP server definition. So we will say that if the user hits the path demo one, and if it is a GET request, we want to respond with a hello world. So you have probably seen it on other demos, other occasions. Nothing complicated here. So what we have defined here is a description of how our server should behave. We still need to actually start an HTTP server. So to do that, we are using the HTTP extension of Akka, that's coming from Akka, and we call the bind and handle method. So the bind and handle method takes a description of the server behavior, so our routes. It takes the name of the interface and the port, 8080. Okay, so now we should be able to actually run this. So now we have to take some time and allow Scala to compile and run. Okay, so this should be running. And let's now localhost demo one. Okay. And we have hello world, so this worked. Okay, that's good. Okay, so now before we go any deeper, just a short explanation of what are the types that are involved here. So first of all, the routes that we have defined, the type of this thing is root. So a root is a very simple thing. It's a function. You can see that it's a type alias. It's a function which takes a request context. A request context is a thing defined in Akka HTTP, and it describes the request that's coming in from the browser or from the user. Okay? So in the request context, you have the path, you have the query parameters, you can access the entity, you can read the headers, and so on. And the result of the function is a future of root result. Root result, again, we can take a look. It's one of two things. It's either a successful result, so complete, which wraps a response, right? Or it's a rejected result, so a failure. So you can see that a root is a simple function taking a request, a description of a request, and returning either failure or success in the future. Okay, so we can have some asynchronicity here. So that's the basic type root, and that's what you pass in to the bind and handle method. Okay, so now how do you define roots? So one way to define a root is to actually write the function, right? So we can write a function which takes a request context and does something with it. But it would get ugly quite quickly if you would want to read parameters and so on. So Akka HTTP, that's all inherited from Spray, by the way, if you have used Spray. So Akka HTTP defines some combinators with which you can define routes, and these are called directives. Okay, so for example, we have a get here. Get is a directive, so we can type this. So we can say get is a directive 0, actually. Okay, and this should compile fine. So a directive is kind of a root combinator. You can think of it as a root transformer. So each directive takes in an inner root. So for example, the get here takes in an inner root. So that's the inner root that it takes. And it returns a root, right? So it's kind of a function, again, which takes a root and returns another root, okay? So similarly, path is a directive that's parameterized by the actual path. So that thing as well is a directive zero, okay? If we go to the definition, you can see that a directive zero is a directive unit. So if we go a bit deeper, you can see that there's a tapply here, which looks kind of like apply, right, from the function one trait. And it, let's forget about the L here, but it takes a root and returns another root. Okay, so that's the root transformation. Okay, so that's directive zero. What about directive one? So there are some directives which take a parameterized root. For example, if we want to read a query parameter, so let's say we want to read the query parameter x, okay? So now we want to actually somehow access the value of x, okay? So we simply, value of x. Why is it red? But it compiles. So that's the idea, don't worry about it. So this directive, it doesn't take a root as a parameter, it takes a parameterized root, okay? And the root is parameterized by the value of the parameter here, okay? So a parameter x directive is a directive 1. And it returns a string. So everything is nicely typed. So the actual, and now it compiles, you see? Huh, that's weird. So the actual type of the value of x is a string, okay? So some directives, for example, the directive 0 doesn't extract anything from the request context. A directive 1 extracts a single string. You can have other directives which extracts ints and so on. So the parameters here would have appropriate types, okay? So in general, a directive takes a nested root parameterized by some types and returns another root. So these are directives. So why should we bother with the directives so much? Well, that's because we can combine them in many nice ways. So for example, we can combine two directives into one and build like larger transformations from smaller ones. So for example, we can create a myGetParameter directive. And we can combine the get and parameter x directive. So that This directive doesn't extract anything from the from the request. This directive extracts a single value, so this will be a directive one in totals because these sum up. And now we can use our new directive instead of the old one. Okay? So that's how you combine two directives. And we can actually, just to have a sanity check, we can see that it still works if we pass in the x parameter and it should get mirrored back. So now if we try to refresh the request, you can see that we are missing the value of the x parameter, x equals 10, and it works. Okay, so nothing very fancy so far. So another nice thing that you can actually do with the directives is you can map over them, okay? So we can create another directive, myGetMappedParameter. So we can take any directive that we want. For example, let's take the directive we have just created, myGetParameter, and we can map the value it extracted, okay? So we take the value and we just duplicate it. Okay, so that's a map as you know it from list, from option, and any other value container in Scala. So we can use that directive instead of our old one, and we can run this now. And the value of the parameter should be duplicated. And it is. Okay? Clear, more or less? Okay. So finally, what you can do with directives is you can flat map them. And that's the ultimate thing that gives you actual power. So my flat mapped parameter. So for example, we can read the parameter where. And depending on the value, we can return another directive. So we say flat map. Flat map. So now if the value of where is left, we read from the L parameter. If it's right, we read from the right parameter. And if the value is something else, we just provide an unknown value. Okay, we need to provide something because all these directives extract a single value, right? So here we kind of extract a value that is given, so it's kind of a unit in the directive one monad. Okay, so we can now try to use that. We can now try to use this my flat map parameter, and let's run this code. Okay. So now if we refresh, we are missing the request parameter where. So if we add where equals left, that's unknown, left. So now it's trying to read the L parameter, right? So we specify L to be 42, and then we have 42. Now if we use right here, and we add 21 here, we get 21, right? So this all works as expected. Okay. So we can see that you can combine the directives in various ways, right? You can map over them to modify the extracted values, but you can also flat map to use certain directives depending on the value extracted by the other directives, okay? And there's a lot of built-in directives inside of Akka, which you can use. Apart from the ones that we have seen, you can read headers, also a very useful directives is for unwrapping a future. So you pass in a future and it extracts the future value. So you can very nicely combine these directives and build your own as you need. Okay, are things clear? Yeah, there's a question.
What would be if you combine directive one of string and directive one of in? So it would be.
Okay, so the question is what if you combine a directive one with a directive one? You would get a directive two, which extracts two values. And there's a directive up, probably up to directive 22, or something like that, or maybe even higher, I don't know. But you don't want to use directive 22. Okay, so that was the Akka HTTP intro. Any other questions, maybe? Okay, so now a very short session refresher. Okay, so web sessions, you probably have used them before, right? Every time you log in, the web page usually remembers that you are logged in, and it does so by establishing a session. So there are two basic ways of implementing sessions. If you have used servlets, you probably know the server-side session concept. So with server-side sessions, the server generates a random token and it returns it to the user in a cookie, for example. And then on each request, the user sends the cookie and the server then looks up, it has a map from the random token to the actual session data. So on each request, it has to look up the actual session data. The session data usually contains something like a user ID or maybe your username, email, and so on. So that's the server-side solution. It has some drawbacks. For example, you either need to have sticky sessions, so each request has to go to the same server from the same user, right? Or you need to somehow have the a persistent distributed storage of your sessions, if you have more than web server, of course, so that if the user goes to another web server, the session is also there. So you need to use, for example, something like Redis or Memcache or something like that. So if you've used servlets, you probably have seen JSession ID. That's the random token. Another way of doing things is having client-side sessions. When you send the session content back to the client in its entirety, right? And then the only thing that the web server has to do is to deserialize the value that the client has sent him. It doesn't need to do any lookups. And that value contains the user ID, for example, or even the username, and so on. So the whole session content. And that's how things are implemented in Rails or Play, so quite well-known web frameworks. And this is how we will implement session in Arc HTTP session as well. Okay, so of course, if you are using client-side sessions, this needs to be made secure, so you cannot just send the session, like the user ID, and rely on the client sending back the proper session ID back, because, well, clients are evil, right? They can do all kinds of things. The session can be stolen, and they can be erased by an attacker. So we have to somehow make sure that the session content is actually valid, right? And this is done by signing the session content. So what you do is you have a server secret. The server secret is a long random string that has to be shared across all servers. So what you do before sending the session to the client, you take the client content as a string, you append the server secret, and you hash it, or something like that, more or less. And that's the signature, and then you append the signature to the session content, right? And when you receive the session back, you have to you have to verify that the signature matches, okay? If you change the server side secret, you kind of log out each user, right? Because all the sessions become invalid. So the content of the session can be either readable on the client side, or it can be encrypted. So in some cases, you may want to have the session content visible on the client side, or maybe you want to hide the actual user ID that's used in the system, and you don't want the users to see that. So these are all valid options. Okay, so how are sessions stored? So historically, most popular were cookies, right? You said they work kind of out of the box. On the server, you set a set cookie header. The cookie is set on the client, and then it is sent on each request automatically. You don't have to do anything. However, cookies have a long history of being not very secure, so there were many ways to steal a cookie and to hijack sessions and so on. So you probably have heard about attacks, cross-site scripting, CSRF, which is cross-site request forgery. So for most of these attacks, you actually have to code your site reasonably well to prevent them. But in some cases, the framework can help you as well. And also cookie attributes, which help you make things more secure. For example, you can say that a cookie should only be used on HTTPS websites by setting the secure attribute. Or you can use the HTTP only attribute if you don't want the cookie to be accessible from JavaScript. As an alternative, you don't have to use cookies. You can send the author the session content or the tokens in custom headers, but then you actually need to append the custom headers to each request yourself. Okay? It's not a lot of work, it is some work, and you can persistently store the session content in local storage, which is an HTML5 feature. I think it works in most browsers nowadays. So that's an alternative to cookies that you might want to use. It requires a bit more work. Okay, one important thing to keep in mind when dealing with sessions, each session should have an expiry date, should be reasonably short. So there is a mechanism in cookies where you can set an expiry date on a cookie, but of course you can't trust that, right? Because it's all managed by the client, so we can't expect the client or the attacker to be nice enough to delete the cookie after its expiry date. Especially we can't trust the attacker. So what you have to do is you need to embed an expiry date in your cookie, in your session data, and this also has to be part of the signature. Okay, so the expiry must be also included in the signature that's calculated so that we can validate on the server that nobody has tampered either with the session data or with the expiry date. There's also a mechanism in the cookies called session cookies. So if you don't set an expiry date on a cookie, it's supposed to be a session cookie which is deleted after the user quits the browser. But first of all, nobody quits the browsers nowadays. And secondly, the browsers don't delete session cookies often anyway. So Chrome and Firefox will actually preserve the session cookies between sessions. So it's quite kind of useless. Okay. So apart from sessions and session data, you often have a remember me mechanism on website. So it's a mechanism to actually stay logged in for a prolonged period of time. And the way it offers, so there's many ways of actually implementing this, but the way it's quite often implemented is that in addition to session data, there's an additional remember me token sent to the client, either through an additional cookie or through an additional custom header. And that remember me token is then used to restore the session. If the proper session expired, you can use the token to re-establish the session. And here the mapping between the token and the actual session data can be stored on the server. So to restore the session, you actually have to look up the token in a persistent storage. So why are we doing this on the server here? So first of all, these are tokens which allow you to be re-logged in, and they are usually valid for a long period of time. You probably want to have control over the tokens, and you want to have the possibility, for example, to remotely log out a user, right? So to remove, either to remove all tokens and to force everybody to re-authenticate, or to force a given user to re-authenticate. And you may also want to have different permission levels for users which have just authenticated and for users which have a restored session, right? So it's quite common nowadays that if you do some crucial operations and you have a session restored from a remember me token, you actually have to re-authenticate using your password. And the remember me tokens are rotated on each login, so a new one is generated. And so that's also for security, that an attacker, even if he steals a remember me token, it's not very useful if you log in. Okay, now on the mobile, it's more or less the same thing, except that mobile apps don't really use cookies; they more often use custom headers. But the principles here are the same. Maybe the tokens lived longer, right? If you log into a mobile app, then you usually stay logged in for a long time and don't have to re-log in as often as on a website. So finally, before we go to code again, there's a thing called JSON Web Tokens. it's JSON-based, as the name kind of reveals. So you can think of it as a way of serializing session data into a string. So here it's serialized into a JSON. The JSON consists of three parts. There's the header. The header contains the name of the hashing algorithm used. There's the payload, which is the actual session data, like the user ID, username, user email. And there's the signature, which is calculated from the payload using the hashing algorithm. Okay? JSON web tokens are usually passed in headers, set authorization when sent from the client, and authorization when sent from the client. The nice thing is that they are kind of a standard, so there's a lot of integrations available. For example, if you use Angular and you send your sessions in JWT and you install a plugin, the proper headers will be automatically added on each request without you having to do anything. But for the purpose of sessions, you can think about it as another way of serializing the session content. Okay, so now let's see how this translates to Akka HTTP. So I have another demo here. We have all the implicits ready. I have a very simple website. It's colorful. That's weird. Anyway, so I have the poor version of IntelliJ. It shouldn't color HTML, but for some reason it does. So the HTML page has a login form where you can log in user given username. It shows the status of the currently logged in user, if there is any, and there's some JavaScript. It's over here. So for example, to get the currently logged in user, it does an AJAX request to API current login. It's a GET, right? To actually log in, it makes a POST request to do login, and we will implement these endpoints in a second and see how these things work. So I have some directives here, which actually serve the HTML to the client. One thing that you haven't seen before is the tilde operator, and it's don't be scared. It's the only operator, it's only symbolic operator defined by Akka HTTP. So you don't see many of these weird characters around. You only see the tilde, and it combines two routes. So the way it works is, if the first root accepts a request, then the request is accepted, and nothing else happens. But if the first root rejects a request, right? So the path doesn't match, the parameters don't match, and so on. The second root is tried. So in case this one. So it's a way to combine several errors in sequence. Okay, so now what we will do is first we need to configure Akka HTTP session. So to do that, even though I wrote the thing, I still need my notes. We need first to create a configuration, session config.default. So what we need to provide is the server secret. So very long string. So we will just, it should be random. It's not very random right now, but it's good for a demo. So the session config contains all the names of the cookies that I used, the names of the custom headers if they're used. It contains the cookie parameters, for example, if the cookies should be HTTP owned and secure. So all the things that can be configurable are configurable in the session config. It's a simple case class. So here we have the cookie config, header config. So you can see that it's a simple case class which you can customize. Another thing that we need is a class or a type that will hold our session. So we can use a string and int, or we can use a custom case class. So here we will use a custom case class. It will be an example session, and it will just contain a single string saying who's logged in, just for demo purposes. So here you can include other fields as well, but still we need to be able to somehow serialize the session into a string and back. So we will just write the serializer really quickly. Implicit serializer. It will be a session serializer from example session to a string. And there's a couple of helper classes built in. New single value session serializer. And to serialize a session, you just get the who, that's a simple string, and to deserialize a session, you just unwrap it example session who. Okay, so we need to import the try. So that will be the session that will be stored. That's the session content, right? And it needs to be serialized to a string to actually send it as a cookie and then restore it. Of course, it can be more complex. Okay, so back to our session config. Another thing we need is the session manager, implicit var session manager. New session manager. It takes the type of the session content as a type parameter, and the session config as a normal parameter. So what the session manager does, it knows how to serialize and sign sessions. So if you would want to customize the process of signing, then you can override a method there. If you would want to use a JWT, there's a session manager subclass which you can use, and it will actually serialize your classes to JWT. Okay. So now we have the session manager. Last thing that we need before doing actual coding, we need to import the HTTP session directives, and another thing is session options. Okay, so the standard directives are over here. Okay, and HTTP session is really a set of custom directives built out from the built-in directives as we have seen in the beginning, and they reside in this object. Okay, so now let's actually implement. So first of all, maybe we will implement the path prefix. So if the user hits the API path, now if you want to login, so now this will serve the /API/do login endpoint. If it's a post, we want to read the request entity as a string. We want to read the request body as a string, because as you can see here, the request body is the name of the user that we want to log in. So we don't do any security here. We just log in everybody as they come. So that's the username that's passed in from the front end. So now what we want to do, we will just do a print line just to see that things work. Logging in username. Okay. So now what we want to do is we want to set a new session, right? Because we log in a user, so we call set session, which is a custom directive. And we need to pass in some parameters. So we can either have one-off sessions or long sessions with remember me tokens. So here we will just use single shot sessions without setting remember me tokens. We are going to use cookies as our transport. An alternative is to use custom headers. So if you would want to use custom headers instead of cookies, you would just have to use headers here. Okay? But then you would need some support on the front end to actually read the custom header and send it back. With cookies, it's more automatic. And we need to actually provide the content of the session. We set the session, example session, and with the body, so with the username. So this is a directive which modifies the response, right? It adds the cookie to the response. Okay? And now we still need to complete the request somehow. So we just complete it with an okay. Okay, so that's one endpoint. Now we need another endpoint to log out. So again, if it's a post, the first thing we do before logging out, we have to make sure that there is a session. So we read a session with a required session. Same parameters, using cookies. And now we call invalidate session because we want to log the user out. And now we complete with an OK. And finally, the final endpoint that we need to implement is to get the current login, right? So to see the status. So if it's a get, we read the session from the cookies, from the incoming headers, using cookies. and session. Okay, so the nice thing about the required session directives is that this value, which parameterizes the inner directive, it's properly typed. So the type of session here, oh, my timer just went, yeah. That mean I'm out of time? Hopefully not. Okay, so the session here has the proper type. It's an example session. And that's all through the implicit session manager, which knows the type of the session. Okay? Okay, so the session here has the proper type. So I can just complete with session.who. Right, because that's the name of the that's the parameter that's stored in the session. Okay. Now the required session directive, if there is no session present, will fail the request with a 403. So that's what you usually want. You can also optionally read a session, so you can get an option of your session type and do some things depending on. Know what the outcome is. Okay, so now let's try running this and we'll see if this actually works. Okay. So now let's refresh. Because we have the old path here. Okay, we have the form. You can see that currently when trying to get the logged in user, there's error 403. So I can log in as Adam. So now you can see I'm logged in. I can refresh the page, and without any query parameters and so on, it still knows I'm Adam, so it's probably coming from the cookie. I can log out, so now I can log it out. We can log in as another person. We can now look at the actual storage over here. So if you look at the cookies, it's very small, but you can see the cookies there, right? And the session is not encrypted. You can see that at the end is actually the session content, so my login. If we encrypted the session, which is just a matter of changing a configuration parameter, this will be encrypted and you wouldn't see the actual session content. If we delete the cookie, I'm logged out again. Okay, so that's how things basically work. So in a typical, more real world application, you would probably build your own session directives using these ones, right? So for example, you would want to serve both web and mobile clients. So you can create a custom read session directive, which would use cookies for web clients and custom headers for mobile clients. So for example, you could, the same way we built the directives in the beginning, so you could build my read session, right? So you could, for example, read some custom header so to determine if the request comes from mobile or not, is mobile, right? And then you can flat map this and either use this directive or the other, right? So case true, for example, we can use this one. And in case of others, we can, so here we would using headers, and otherwise we read using cookies, right? So in that way you can build your own directives, combining the directives that are built into ACK HTTP and the custom directive provided by ACK HTTP session, which it can be just another building block in your application. And by defining custom directives, you can create really nice kind of DSLs for defining your HTTP endpoints. Okay, so I'm almost done. Two more things. I have some not related to ACK HTTP. I have some Scala Times stickers if you'd like them. Scala Times is a weekly newsletter that we are sending out each week, gathering Scala news from the last week. And I would also like to invite you to Scalar, which is the spring version of B-Scala. It's taking place in Warsaw in April. There's a call for papers in progress. You can register as well. So please feel invited and encouraged to submit to the call for papers. And that's it for the presentation. The source code is, of course, open source. If you would like to see how these directives are actually implemented, they are quite simple. If you go to the source, you can see that the set session and read session and so on, they actually all reuse existing directives, mapping, flat mapping, and so on. So it's all quite simple. If you have any questions, I can take some now or later. Yeah.
So my question is that I noticed some similarity between Spark and Akka HTTP in terms of how do you use lambdas. So when you use lambdas, this is pretty opaque. The framework doesn't have any clues what's happening inside.
Yeah.
This is creating some problems in Spark, but also in this Akka HTTP. I noticed that people were asking if it supports Swagger.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. It doesn't. Exactly for this reason, because you cannot. You can only do some basic code analysis to automatically generate a description of your endpoints. But in theory, it can be arbitrary code with arbitrary ifs and so on, which can do anything, yeah.
Yeah, so my question is, are you aware of any approaches that try to solve it? For example, by providing some data structures that then get compiled to lambdas?
So I know there is a plugin for the compiler, which tries to generate Swagger docs from HTTP, but it of course supports only the basic directives if they are written without any conditional logic and so on. So we can do it, but otherwise, I'm not aware of any such efforts.
Of any data sets, data frames?
No. Well, they could exist, but I just don't know about them. Okay. But yeah, it is quite a powerful way to define your APIs because you can. It's just code, right? So what you do here is you just define, in fact, functions from request context to the future of response. So it's a powerful way to define your APIs. It gives you a lot of flexibility, and you can create all the nice directives. But on the other hand, you lose the ability to process the description of the APIs in a machine way, right? So. Trade-offs, as always. Any other questions, maybe? Okay, thanks a lot. I'm here till the end of the conference. Oh, there's one more question.
The question is more related to JVT and the whole idea of mobile first. So isn't it the idea that you should basically do a front end and website? Like I said, mobile first, so you actually, from that point of view, we have the same solutions for using an application or web application. It turns out to be the same. Or like
what
last thing you showed
is
a separation from mobile and
okay. So yeah, I guess it's nice to have the same thing on web and mobile, but it's I guess reality isn't always that nice. So yeah, if I had the choice, I would probably want to have everything coded the same way, maybe even using the same code. But in reality, I guess, you know, things differ. If there are always some edge cases, if it's a mobile client on a non-mobile client, maybe not authentication, but maybe it's something else. So yeah, definitely, if possible, you're right. This should be the same. Okay, thanks a lot.